You're listening to The Dean Blundell Show on 102.1 The Edge. Some of the material on The Dean Blundell Show is not suited for all audiences. Listener discretion is strongly advised.
It's like everything everywhere is going crazy, so we don't go out anymore. We sit in the house, and slowly the world we're living in is getting smaller, and all we say is, please, just leave us alone. Well, I'm not going to leave you alone. I want you to get mad. I want all of you to get up out of your chairs and go to the window. Open it and stick your head out and yell.
The Dean Blundell Show.
This is mass madness, you maniacs.
102.1 The Edge.
This is your Edge.
Damn it. Hold it.
Files with Dean Blundell on the Edge.
Doctors in Southern California trying to solve the mystery of a Florida woman who was found, Florida man rather, who was found unconscious at a Palm Springs motel and awoke with amnesia. Likely story.
Yeah.
An identity that doesn't match the ID found on him and the ability to only speak and understand Swedish.
What?
Yeah. The man, 61-year-old Michael Boatwright, doesn't sound Swedish. Woke up claiming his name was Johan Ek. Hospital officials believe he may have been in town for a tennis tournament because he was found with a duffel bag and exercise clothes, but says he doesn't think he's ever played tennis.
This is crazy.
It was one of those crazy tennis sex games.
Oh.
Yeah. He had a backpack, tennis rackets, along with four forms of identification, confirming him as Michael Thomas Boatwright. Doctors have since diagnosed him with something called transient global amnesia, a condition triggered by... Yeah. Condition triggered by physical or emotional trauma that can last for several months. He has no idea how to exchange money, take public transportation, or understand English, nor does he recall the existence. Here, you'll like this.
Yeah.
Of his two ex-wives.
Oh, I get it. I get it.
Yeah, I imagine amnesia is way cheaper than divorce.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's more newsworthy.
Yeah, it sure is. And cooler, too. Yeah. Like, it'd be really cool to wake up and just know how to speak Swedish.
Or think you do. It's like, it's more like the chef from the Muppets.
Yeah, that would be awesome. Do you remember your ex-wives? Do you remember you have to pay alimony? Makers of a phone battery might be into some stinky stuff. A new smartphone, they say they can power, it can be powered by human urine.
Oh.
Yeah. Not sure how the folks at Bristol Robotics Laboratory got the idea to put pee in their phones, but they managed to successfully get enough power to get a short call out of a single stream of urine.
Imagine those long distance calls.
Oh man, you
that's when you've had
a lot of
water, of coffee and beer. Yeah. And what a smell!
Out. Yeah. How many times have people dropped their phone in the urinal though?
That's true.
You know,
trying to power up.
Yeah, exactly. Just drop it in and then pick it. But I don't know how it works. The urine that the cells soak up and the acid in them charge the actual phone itself. I don't know how it works. One product they can be sure of an unending supply is your own whiz, they say. So that's why they said they started to do it.
That's just like they should invent cars that run on
poop,
on farts.
They do.
They do?
Yeah, dude. They got a car in Australia that what happens is you put like cow poop in it.
Yeah.
You know, feces.
Yeah.
You know.
Like
waste.
Number two.
Yeah, and it's powered by the also methane gas powers vehicles now, and that's pig farts.
So is this like the big corporations are keeping these new technologies down?
I don't know.
Because that is the greatest thing in the world between your pissed cell phone and your poop car.
Yeah,
you're free to travel.
Do whatever you want. And a dude in Florida arrested after he secretly videotaped a young woman in his bathroom. Arnaldo Martinez, a 54-year-old, arrested on charges of felony voyeurism. Deputy said he had placed a hidden camera in the bathroom to determine whether or not, this is what he told police, whether or not the 22-year-old woman had tattoos in her pelvic area.
Oh,
I was just checking.
That's a lot of work. You could have just asked.
A woman was using the bathroom. She looked up at a vent, saw a camera, followed the line. That went all the way to the attic where he had a little TV set up.
A control room.
Yeah, he did. there was a mattress and a whole bunch of Kleenex in there.
Ready to take two.
Anyway, so she pulled out the camera, followed it all the way upstairs, confronted the guy, called the police. He told the police that he admitted to putting the camera in the vent because he was, if his step, it was his stepdaughter, had tattoos in her pelvic area, something that the mom said she didn't want her to have. Now, that was news to the mom.
Yeah, because I'm sure she wouldn't have wanted him to do it that way.
You got to think of a better excuse than I'm
checking.
Yeah, I
know. Just, yeah. Say it was for his wife, and she just, the wrong person came into the room or something like that, you know? But.
He signed a consent to allow deputies to search the home for any video recording material. They found cameras, storage cards in the bedroom, and over 200 hours of videotape of just guests coming in to use the bathroom. Guys and girls.
What's his name again?
Arnaldo Martinez.
Yeah, that's about right.
Why?
Just sounds like a creepy name.
Those are your Edge Files, whatever the hell day it is in July, the year 2013.
The Edge Files
on 102.1.
The Edge.
This is on 102.1. The Edge.
The cause of death in the Cory Monteith. You know, I hate to use it as a springboard to excellence, but I called it.
Yeah.
And people started tweeting me yesterday. They're like, "You called it, man. You're right. It was heroin." Heroin and alcohol. They call it a mixed toxicity. It was an accidental death. So. It's too bad too, because I love that show. It won't be the same without him.
He's more famous to me now after this incident than.
Oh yeah, a lot of people say. I talked to a guy yesterday. He's like, I didn't know who he was. He's just like you. He's like, I had to look it up. I know who this Cory Monteith guy is. Still sad.
Of course it is. How will they handle it on the show? I wonder.
That, great question. I don't know. I don't, maybe he just goes away. I don't know if they deal with it. Maybe they do a live one. Who knows? But all accounts, just a great guy. Loved the Canucks.
Oh.
Loved the BC Lions. He was a Vancouver kid, born in Calgary. Dad was in the Army. Mom was an interior decorator. He played the drums, got addicted to drugs, and he was like 13 years old. Fast forward to 19, his family tells him to go. Like, that's pretty early to be ramping it up as 19.
Yeah. It's because he played the drums.
Yeah, he was badass.
Yeah.
Anyway, just got out of rehab, like not even a month before he accidentally overdosed on heroin and alcohol. This is the coroner. Okay. This is a woman who also looks nearly dead. And this is her talking about, so this is the official BC coroner's office, statement here.
Okay. Good afternoon. We're here today to announce that we do now have a cause of death, in the tragic death of Cory Monteith. And that cause of death was a mixed drug toxicity, and it involved heroin primarily and also alcohol. For background, Mr. Monteith, who was 31 years old, was found deceased on Saturday, the 13th of July, in his hotel room in downtown Vancouver, where he'd been staying for about a week. That's really all the information we have at this point. The coroner's investigation is continuing. Mr. Monteith's family is, of course, aware of the circumstances of his death, and we do, on behalf of them, ask for privacy as they go through this grieving process. And we do express our most heartfelt condolences to them and to all Mr. Monteith's friends, of whom we know we had a lot in British Columbia. We should also say at this point, there's absolutely nothing at this point, no evidence to suggest this is anything other than the most sad and tragic accident. The coroner's service won't be making any further comments on this issue until their investigation is finally concluded.
And there you go. So there's your official statement. It was heroin and alcohol. And you know, the funny part is, and I actually had a conversation with someone about this a long time ago. You know Scott Weiland, the lead singer of Stone Temple Pilots.
Yeah.
Among other things, big heroin addict. I think he's gone through it. I don't know if he still does. But it must be an awesome drug.
It must be.
It must be one of the greatest feelings in the world for you to be able to chuck it all away like that. And I know it was accidental, but it still must be incredible.
I'd do it if it wasn't for all the scarring.
No, I wouldn't.
If it wasn't for the scarring, I'd be all over that crap.
But people like Lester, and I've had dental work done where you've had to actually, you know, they give you Percocets or OxyContin, whatever, oxycodone, whatever it's called. And, I never took them because you start with that stuff and pretty soon
The lead-in.
Yeah, that's the gateway drug. Weed is not a gateway drug.
And did you say that he'd just come out of rehab?
Yeah. And once again, What a terrible place to go to rehab.
Like, yeah.
Totally didn't work.
I think it was the Heath Ledger Rehab Center.
I don't know.
Or was it Chris Farley Rehab Center?
Might have been one of the same ones. Super sad, though.
Yeah, totally sad. And your theory, so you were right. You thought it was heroin.
Yeah, well, because it's anytime someone dies suddenly like that,
yeah,
it's usually drug-related.
I was way off.
What did you say?
Old age.
Dude, he's 31.
They go a lot sooner.
No, it was heroin.
Okay.
Yeah, he's only 31. Good-looking dude, too.
Yeah, and he was playing like, what, like an 18-year-old or something on the show?
Yeah.
It's a weird show. Yeah. It's a weird show.
No, it's not the same now. Anyway.
Less gleeful.
Yeah, well, big time.
This is the Dean Blundell Show on 102.1 The Edge.
Time for your emails and tweets. Someone sent me this great email. Hey, guys, did you see this lady on YouTube? Doesn't like bears. She's giving bear advice. This is a overly animated news reporter demonstrating how to probably not survive a bear encounter. Now, you got to understand, she's doing the actions as well. She's blonde. She's got crazy bingo wings. You know what those are? Bingo wings.
Like, she used to be probably really overweight. Now she lost a lot of weight. Now she's got some, like, the flying squirrel skin.
Yeah, yeah. So when you shake it, and you know why, is when someone yells bingo, it looks like a wing. It's like, call it a bingo wing. But she's doing these actions. I should tweet it, is what I should do.
Yeah, do it.
Or twote. Tweet, twote. And the funny part of this entire video, too, it makes me laugh. The video of this lady, specifically this lady doing this little routine, is that her eyes, specifically when you see it, shake back and forth like she's got Tourette's.
Oh.
I'll tweet it later. Anyway, this is a professional Rhode Island NBC reporter, Julie Tremel, giving advice on how to survive a bear attack. Someone was attacked by a bear in the neighborhood, I guess.
Since Matt admits he had absolutely no clue what to do when he came face to face with this massive 300-pound bear, we here at NBC 10 figured we should put together a few tips from the experts to help protect yourself should you come across a curious bear.
Yeah.
According to experts, you should avoid direct eye contact with the bear. Don't run away. Instead, back off slowly. Wave your arms to let the animal know you're human. Don't yell. Stay quiet unless the bear attacks. Then scream and throw things at the bear. If the bear...
She took her... Just so you know, she took her shoes off and she started throwing them at the camera. And that was her screaming, literally her screaming. Here, have a listen.
Stay quiet unless the bear attacks. Then scream and throw things at the bear. If the bear attacks, curl up into a ball on your side or lay flat on your stomach.
Just so he can eat you efficiently.
Don't make it hard for the bear.
With the bear, don't run away. Instead, back off slowly.
Who isn't going to run away from a bear attack? I'm running as fast and as hard as I can.
Yeah, I'll take my chances with the running.
I'm not attacking a bear. I'm not throwing things at a bear. You're going to piss the bear off.
Talk to
the
bear.
Your arms to let...
Yeah, yeah.
Reason with
Cover
him.
Yourself in liverwurst.
The animal know you're human. Don't yell. Stay quiet unless the bear attacks. Then scream and throw things at the bear. If the bear attacks, curl up into a ball on your side or lay flat on your stomach. And above all, stay calm. In Cranston, Julie Tremel, NBC 10 News, The Night Team.
The great part of the video is when she's laying on her stomach just so the bear can get a good eat on. Is her whale tail thong is sticking out.
Oh, no. Frank, I need you to go down and cover the Zimmerman thing. Julie,
you do bear tips. Safety tips.
I smell Pulitzer.
Oh, man. Another email. Hey, guys, I just this is from Twitter as well. I loved your penis-sized conversation from yesterday. My boyfriend has a 6-incher. He seems to think it's too small. What do you think?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Probably you missed it by about an inch.
I would say 6 to 7 inches is usually, I think that's the Canadian average. We said yesterday the American average is what, 5.6?
5.6, yeah.
14.2 centimeters.
Yeah.
That's what I would be telling everybody if it was 5.6. It's actually 14 and a half.
If you're in Canada.
I have a Canadian. How big's your wiener? In Canadian, it's 14 and a half.
Welcome to the club.
Yeah. But I started to wonder, and maybe Nicole can help us with this. Nicole, can you come over for a sec? Our call screener, Nicole, everybody. Say hi to Nicole.
She may or may not know some things about...
I guarantee she did. She went out last night with some guy.
With her swipe?
No, it wasn't a swipe date. It wasn't one of those swipe dates, was it?
No, it wasn't.
It was like a real date.
It was a real date.
Where did you meet him?
Through a friend of mine.
Did you see it?
No.
What is it, and this is the truly perfunctory.
Great word.
give me the size, like a preferred size. You and your girls talk, right?
Oh, yeah.
So you guys all talk about wiener size. Y'all talk about...
Yeah. Oh, of course. Like, the ideal size is something that's like...
Like the size of a jumbo juicy?
Yeah.
Like almost... Not quite a jumbo freezy, but a little
like
bit
a taquito,
bigger.
A little bit bigger than a taquito, one of those buffalo chicken taquitos at 7-Eleven.
Yeah.
Aren't like jumbo freezies like 18 inches long?
I said smaller than a jumbo freezy, but
so
larger
17
than a
inches
regular one.
Without those awful plastic
smaller
corners,
than it. Yeah.
Yeah, you cut your mouth on those.
If your boyfriend's wiener looks like a jumbo freezy, he needs to go for a corrective surgery
or into porn.
No. But give me a size. Like, inch it out. Is it 6? Is it 8? What is it? What is it like that?
I think a good 7.
A good 7?
A good solid 7.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
for,
I think... And
for those losers out there.
Yeah.
A good solid 7 inches.
Yeah.
And what about girth?
Good girth, too.
Like what? Like this? Like bigger than a toonie?
Bigger than a toonie, yeah.
Whoa.
It's like a...
Like a silver dollar pancake?
Maybe
like
a little
can
bit.
Of can of beef vegetable soup.
That's
Alan's apple juice.
Alan.
It's not a cave down
you had
there.
You had to go for like a name brand
darn
too.
Right.
Alan's apple juice, like a can of V8, one of the big ones, a party size V8 can.
Maybe like you know those little cans of like tomato paste you get for chili. One of those.
Oh, that's a good
that's
call.
That's pretty girthy.
That's pretty thick. Not the paste.
Yeah.
The can. It's a pretty thick. That's
that is.
You're
that's
asking. You're asking for trouble. There
I
is
shoot
what you're.
For the stars.
Yeah. Well, you'd be seeing stars after something that thick.
I hope so.
But you've obviously been with guys that have had smaller things.
Yeah, it's unfortunate.
Like drumsticks.
What's the smallest you've seen?
Oh, it's smallest probably like 4 or 5. But it's like
was
more
he
like
injured?
The really skinny one.
Was he hurt?
Was he hurt by what I said?
No, was he hurt at some point?
He was 3 feet tall.
He's.
Oh, no, I don't think so. He never disclosed any.
Was it circumcised?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because for guys, I would imagine for guys that have small things, they would probably rather not be circumcised.
Yeah, because you want to get
every centimeter
get.
Counts.
Unhood the goods.
Oh, is that what it's called? Unhooding the goods?
You're the expert here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. But
that's
like,
too big, though. The suit, the tomato paste thing is too big.
And the jumbo freezy tomato paste.
Way too long.
Like we're getting into Louisville slugger territory here.
Yeah. It's this thing. Maybe she's just really experienced.
Oh, God. No.
You know like, someone's arm?
Like a really like, muscular one? In a fist?
Yeah. You know, one of those.
No, like, okay, maybe a little bit smaller than a can. Probably about the size of, like...
Like a Red Bull?
No, Red Bulls are still big, especially the jumbo cans.
I can only put it in terms of groceries. That's all I know.
I'm trying to think. There's nothing really comparable. It
well, you're blind,
like
so it's all
yeah,
feel
it
to you,
to
right?
Like
you're trying to think of, like, you're sizing, because you size things up with your hands, so you felt your own stuff for a very long time.
Yes.
So now you're just going, oh, maybe the size of a,
you notice
of a
I
Red
didn't,
Bull.
I didn't go to me.
Yeah.
So I...
No, you went to objects
yes,
that
I
you
did.
Know feel a certain way.
Yes.
It can't be skinny, though. Skinny's just...
Skinny's
like,
bad?
Yeah, like... Little teeny tiny.
I know what
things.
Skinny
yeah,
means.
Thanks.
You don't have to explain skinny. I get it. You don't like guys with skinny wieners.
No.
Okay.
No, that's off the table.
In general, people don't like guys with skinny wieners.
It's gross.
Is it gross?
It is. It's a little bit gross.
Or is it just like, has there like, ever been a deal breaker where you've said,
yeah.
You know what? I can see what's going on here, and I got something to do right now, and I gotta go.
I just got up and left once.
What?
Yeah.
He must have felt awesome about himself.
Didn't call him back either.
You didn't?
No. Why would I? I was
See,
there.
I wonder if chicks get to that point and they just humor the guy and go, all right, I'll do some stuff to it.
All right, Mr. Dowling.
I'm not that nice.
No.
I just, it's a waste of time, really and truly.
Because you're not going to get anything out of it?
Right.
That's a very male way to think, by
the
way.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
It's a two-way street.
I remember
street.
One time fooling around, it was like high school, and a girl had one nipple.
What?
Yeah, and I left. I did, because I said
I felt like it was winking at you?
No, I couldn't stop laughing. No. Like, this is awesome. Half of you is like a Barbie.
Where did the other one go?
I didn't ask.
Farming accident.
I didn't ask. Hey, where's the other one?
Yeah. What happened to nip number one there? Lefty.
Yeah. Where'd it go? What happened? No, I didn't ask. I remember looking at it going, this is very odd. And I left. And like left the whole party because I couldn't stop laughing.
Oh, was that a party?
Yeah.
Did she just like hear my nipples?
No, she didn't say hear my nipples at the party.
Some girls do.
Well, I need to go to the same parties you go to.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Sure, you can come.
Not if you only see one nipple.
The Dean Blundell Show. 102.1. The Edge.
It's going to be real hot today, so do what you got to do. I think there's, believe it or not, they haven't even called this a heat wave yet. I wonder what qualifies.
I don't know, what's it going to be like 3 months long or something?
Imagine
like
being Rob Ford's underpants.
Oh, this must be the most weight he's ever lost.
Oh, man.
Can just from imagine? Going out to get a hot dog. Yeah.
Just from walking to his car.
295.
So we have breaking Biebs news here real quick. Breaking Biebs news.
It's just in.
Yeah. Douchehole is at it again. Apparently spitting on the third person that I'm aware of.
Yeah, he's a spitter.
Yeah, who'd have thought?
Well, some.
See, that's why I know it's probably not true. Guy swallows.
Big time.
His drinks.
Yeah, of course.
That's so this is from TMZ. Allegedly, he's in a nightclub in Columbus, Ohio, and he horked on someone for taking pictures of him, or seemingly taking pictures. And this is one of the club DJs. Now, I don't know if you know this, but he tours with his own DJ. He's got a tour DJ that plays music for him when he's just kind of hanging out. That's how much of a dickhead he is.
Wow.
Yeah. So we'll pick this up. This is the TMZ story. Listen to the language that this dickhead uses and what happened as the guy tells the story on another radio station.
In the VIP area, and I was basically opening up for his tour DJ. Two of Beaver's bouncers approached me and then said that I was trying to take photos of Justin Bieber, which I guess is a no-no.
Were you trying to?
Nope.
And that's when things got wet.
Bieber looked at the guy straight in the face, said, "Your father's a bitch, your mother's a bitch, and you're a bitch."
And Justin Bieber spit right in my face. And I was just completely stunned.
Do you know what's really interesting about that is it's the second time.
Spitting? Actually, it's the third time.
His next door neighbor says, although Justin denied it, his next door neighbor said Justin spit in his face when the neighbor confronted him for speeding on in his gated community.
And Bieber was accused of spitting in a water bottle by a gym goer who looks like Gwen Stefani.
That's all he does is spit.
That's his. You know when that's when he was getting in the car in London?
Yeah.
Maybe that's what he...
He horked on that British guy. Yeah, that's what he said after. No one believed him. I didn't believe him because I thought that, you know, if anybody's going to be a spitter, it wouldn't be him. But that's what he does. That's his move. He's a horker. He works up a luge and he horks on people.
Just as an aside, I wonder if he was all decked out in his Columbus Blue Jackets gear. When he was at that club, you know how he's like Mr. Chameleon sports guy?
Yeah. He got like Miami Heat when he goes to Miami. And he's
Chicago.
In LA, he's got the Lakers. So Chicago, he's got the Bulls thing.
But he's just...
We've ascertained Justin is a spitter.
Oh, there's so many things you can say.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about a lot of things.
Yeah. When, yeah.
I could spitter. Say about him being a spitter.
And what is reference to?
Yeah, he just has a bad taste in his mouth.
He's a dick.
He is. What has happened to him?
I don't know. Drugs have happened to him. That's what happened to him. You ask any... You know, it's interesting. The wrong Canadian overdosed last weekend.
It's true.
It is. The wrong Canadian overdosed. I liked that Cory Monteith
guy. Yeah, and he meant more nice to people.
Yeah.
Than the Biebs.
I hope he goes all out.
Oh, it's a matter of time, my friends.
I hope the Biebs gets into the hard stuff soon. I hope he's...
he'll still be spitting.
Yeah, maybe for extra money down at the Greyhound station.
The Dean Blundell Show.
On 102.1.
Yeah.
Email from Kelly. She says, good morning, Dean. So after listening to your show yesterday, my husband and I decided to measure his wiener.
Oh. See what we do?
He was different measurements depending on where we measured from. Where do we measure from?
Base, right?
Yep. He thanks you because obviously I had to help him in order to measure. And then, of course, you can't just leave him hanging there. Thanks, Kelly. That is an awesome wife. It is. That is one of the greatest moves ever. Well, let's measure it. Let's see how long it is. But you measure it from the base, I would say.
And do you use one of those sewing ones that are, you know, like...
Oh, like the tape measure?
Yeah.
Like just the cloth one?
Yeah, the cloth one that you can
sort of... Fabricland?
Yeah, or do you get the steel one that you use on job sites?
I think you use a protractor or a compass.
Oh.
You know what I mean? Like the one with the really sharp end.
Just so you know.
You can use anything. You use a ruler.
Yardstick, eh?
No, you can use it. I personally, I mean, there's magazines. And what you can do is you can also go online and you can go and say, okay, I want to measure my thing. And it'll give you a chart as to where you fit in the average. And I suggest you don't do it on your own because that's just weird.
Yeah. Although I might be guilty of that at some point
Have
in my life.
That?
Perhaps in the past, yeah.
Did you measure it for real?
Yeah, just for fun.
With what would you measure it with?
One of them plastic 30-centimeter rulers.
Like the kind you get in school?
I wasn't going to say that, but yes.
Did you measure it in high school?
Yeah. It was one of those...
Did you do it at home?
Yeah, of course.
You didn't do it in the boys' change
no,
room?
No, I didn't do it in the boys' change okay. room. But it was one of those rulers
to walk into.
And me going, Eureka!
A blind guy measuring his wiener in the boys' change room.
Yeah, it was a CNIV Braille one. I'm dot, dot, dot.
I'm feeling this thing is about 6.5. But what did it say?
I'm a good... I'm above average. You know, I'm a good 7. I'm a quality 7. I'm you know, I have pretty large hands. I'm a two-fister.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, know more about me now.
I'm you know, the sad part is that a woman wants to know how you measure it. What do you mean how you measure it? You just measure it.
You measure it.
From the back to the front, top to the back.
No one's interested in the ball size, though, are they? No, is ball size important to people?
I don't know. You'd have to ask it. Badge?
Yes.
Is that important?
Ball size?
You don't want them too massive. Just good.
Because then they become little weapons.
Or you can totally break a
could
chin.
Knock you out, literally.
You can break a chin or a nose.
Exactly. Not good.
Yeah, you can speed bag it.
Yeah.
The Chorus Broadcasting System presents The Dean Blundell Show. It's going to be a super-duper program for you. 102.1.
Yeah. You just eat it. You just eat pitas. We were just talking about pitas. How awesome they just go right in your mouth.
They sure do.
Anyway, time for a Wahop and Best Confession Wins, giving away some Edge Fest tickets. We've also got Toronto Festival beer tickets. Julia's on the phone. Hi, Julia.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Better now.
Uh-oh.
Oh, yeah.
Where are you calling from, first of all?
I'm calling from Oakville.
Okay.
Hey, what happened?
Hey, what happened?
What happened?
Okay, so just happened?
There's more, okay.
You haven't started. You haven't started, so I hope there's more.
Okay. Well, I just got back from Disneyland with my friend's family, and I hadn't gone to the bathroom all week. We're getting off.
What do you mean you haven't gone to the bathroom? Huh? Like, you hadn't pooped?
Yeah, I was constipated for a week.
Oh.
And I was getting off at the Small World singing a song, and I felt like, I'm going to go to the bathroom. So I go, within 2 minutes, I was covered in shit and puke and being wheeled off on a gurney with no pants on by two gorgeous male paramedics.
Hold it. Back it up. Back it up. You can't say the S word. So... get back to do the story again, minus the foul language, but make sure that's okay because it was a good story. I already liked it.
Okay.
So you haven't pooped in a week. You're on It's a Small World ride.
yeah, and I was singing along with those little people. And I get off, and I said I had to go to the bathroom. So I ran to Rapunzel's bathroom, Rapunzel. And I go to the bathroom, and I would say within a minute or two, I was covered in shit and puke, passed out on the bathroom floor.
I asked you not to say the S word, remember?
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry.
Slow learner.
Within 2 minutes, what?
I was going to the bathroom covered in poo and vomit.
Why'd you puke?
I had food poisoning. I went unconscious. I was throwing up and going to the bathroom all over myself. So
well, you missed that part of it. Yeah. You just said you were constipated. I didn't know you had food poisoning, too.
Well, I didn't know that at this point. I had to go to the hospital first. Yeah. So I passed out and covered in my own feces and vomit, and my friend's mom started taking my clothes off so I wouldn't have to go.
Imagine walking into the bathroom right then. You'd think something crazy was going on.
It was pretty crazy. So they called the 911, and they had two gorgeous male paramedics come in. I had no clothes on, covered with vomit and everything.
Yeah, we get that.
And they wheeled me off with no pants on through Disneyland with $3,000 medical bills after that.
You had snow pants? Is that what you said? Or no pants?
No pants.
Okay. I'm wondering where they get snow pants in Florida.
Yeah, that'd be your first problem.
All right. It's snow pants.
Imagine if it was like the paramedics were Mickey and Donald or something.
Yeah.
What a mess.
Carly.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good, thanks.
Good. Where are you calling from?
Richmond Hill.
Okay.
What the happened?
Okay, so it started out in the summer, me and my friend Emily and both of our boyfriends were in my pool, and we were pretty drunk, all four of us, and it kind of started, you go, we go, and...
What do you mean? You and your boyfriend? Or your boyfriend and his... Oh, okay, hold it. So you and her started fooling around, but you said you go, was your boyfriend and your girlfriend's boyfriend, did they fool around too?
Well, we tried, but it didn't happen. So we started making out.
Why don't you just play, do you ever play Marco Polo?
Yeah.
That's a fun pool game.
it was too late at night for that.
Oh, yeah. There's a deadline on the Marco Polo. Yeah. It's got to happen before 10.
When the sun goes down.
Okay, so you and your girlfriend start making out.
Yeah, and I'm not sure how it happened. We ended up on the diving board, and we were 69ing on the diving board, and both our boyfriends were in the pool, and it was fine. And then both my parents came home, all the lights in the house came on, so we both kind of freaked out, and I flipped backwards into the pool. She skidded face first down the diving board, and... We wake up the next morning, her face is black and blue, and she slapped her boyfriend in the face because she thought he hit her. So we had no memory of what had happened, and then
weird.
We had to put everything back together. And we couldn't tell my parents.
Oh!
Yeah. Get with it. At the Edge.
How's it going?
Good, Jana. How are you?
Not too bad.
Where are you calling from?
Only in Hamilton.
What the
Well, this should be good.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Okay, so I was dating this new girl, and I went to her apartment for the weekend, so I left my dog with my mother.
Dating a girl?
Pardon me? Yes, I was dating a girl, yeah. So I came home, because you don't want to shower yet. It was really new. I came home. Walk in my apartment and my toilet seat's up. Well, I got a couple cats, so you know what? You don't want to leave your toilet seat up because they get in there and cause a mess. So I'm like, oh, maybe I was high and left the toilet seat up. No. Then I find in my bedroom that the mirror has been moved in my bedroom to against the other wall. And I'm like, oh my God, I think somebody's been in my apartment. So I look over to my left and there's a wine bottle opener with a cork attached to it on my dresser. And I'm like, holy crap, somebody had broken into my apartment. I found lube. I found a condom. My bed was broken. There was wine not spilled on my wall. And I was losing my mind. I was in my, and I live by myself. So I'm like, oh my God. So I'm calling my mom, nothing. I see my mother across. I live beside a park.
So
I'm very disappointed in these ladies today. Usually you come with better stuff. Jess. Hi, Jess.
Hello.
How are you?
Good, thank you. How are you?
Good. Where are you calling from?
Toronto.
What happened?
So I was at a barbecue at my ex-boyfriend's house. It was some of his friends and his family. And we went upstairs to his bedroom, and we're in there for about 45 minutes, and there's a knock on the door. And through the door, we hear his dad. He's like, hey, Andrew, are you in there? Like, what's going on? He's like, oh, I just passed out for a second. I'll be out in a sec. He opens the door, sees us both in a very, well, I was in a compromising position. And he's like, oh, geez, he shuts the door, starts yelling at us through the door for some reason. And then I want to stop.
So boring.
Three
boring. You know it's bad when you got to give it to the first caller. You got to go back. Congratulations, Julia. Hi, you win. Only because you're the only person left.
Thank you very much. I'm excited.
I think being constipated for a week was enough. You had me at constipated for a week. I didn't know you had food poisoning. That's also good.
This is the Dean Blundell Show. 102.1.
So it's going to be very hot today. It's like 33 degrees outside here in the city of Toronto. And I wanted to just another reminder, because this happened twice more yesterday. Dickheads leaving kids in cars.
Yeah, what is with that?
I don't know. But it's so, you can't leave, and I can't believe we have to say this. It's almost like, you know, the warning on a toaster says don't operate in the bathtub. Don't leave your kids in the goddamn car. I don't care how old they are. I don't care if you like them or not. I don't care if you think they drank enough water to exist for 20 minutes while you run into the Holt Renfrew. It doesn't matter. Happened again yesterday. A 9-month-old and a 2-year-old here around the city. I mean, it is, and don't crack a window. That doesn't work either. That's for dogs, and that's usually reserved for the fall or the winter.
But this time of year, even dogs, you shouldn't do it.
If your car is running, don't leave the kid. You can't leave your children in the car unattended while you go inside and buy trinkets and baubles. You can't do that. Your kids will die. It happened. The terrible story. And not only was a 2-year-old in Milton. Was that the
the grandma.
Yeah, the grandma who forgot. And you know what? I tweeted this. I don't know how. And it's always tragic. As tragic as it always is. Quit leaving your kids in the car. And if you have a scene watching your kids, get someone else. And I know everybody's devastated when it happens. But I'm a 2-year-old girl. And this is this a 2-year-old girl and a 9-month-old boy. And now people are starting to get pissed off. And this happened the other day. So the 9-month-old's in the car. The mother, the stupid idiot, she's inside doing something. Kids crying, sweating profusely, freaking out. And you know what happened? Passersby stopped, broke the window, took the kid out, which, you know, it's no man's land. But if it's a little kid, you got to help him.
Of course.
So anyway, then the mother comes back. And she almost gets beat up. She gets verbally assaulted and almost gets beat up by this crowd of people who know much better than her that you shouldn't leave your kids in the car.
And there's been a rash of these things.
I honest to God counted, and just here in Toronto, this is like the 6th time in the past 2 weeks that some idiot has left their kid in the car.
And it just happens to be the hottest time of the year, too.
Yeah.
Come on.
I would like to lock Justin Bieber in a car.
Yeah, while I go off gambling.
Yeah, for hours on end. But Jesus, people, stop leaving your kids in the car.
It's common sense.
There's another story, and I don't know how long ago it was in the States. This woman, she runs in, kids, and it's not hot, it's at night, leaves the kids in the car, leaves the car running while she takes off. And some guy carjacks her while her kids are in the back. Drives around, kids are freaking out. He's like,
"Oh no!
Oh, I better stop this car. This is a loud kidnapping. I just wanted to steal beer. Now I'm a kidnapper." So he's, thank God, stopped the car and took off. The kids were fine. Don't leave your kids in the car.
Maybe that's a way that people are preventing carjackings down in the States.
Leaving their kids in
there.
Oh, it's like the club.
Yeah, it's the kids club.
Human. No one's going to steal this with those kids in here. Don't leave your kids in the car, please.
Be wise.
Just, I know it's a little extra work, but how hard is it to go in the back undo a buckle, lift the child out, take the kid in with you. Most of them can walk. Hold the hand, walk in, do your thing, walk out. If you're going to the mall today. Here's another one that it happened in Detroit like 10 years ago. Guy just went to work and forgot his one-year-old was in the car.
Oh. It's a pretty quiet kid.
Yeah. Anyway, just be careful, people, please.
You are listening to the Dean Blundell Show.
102.1 The Edge.
Steve-O's back. He's on the phone. Hey, dude.
Yeah, dude. What's the story over here, man? You're a TV star coming up, huh?
They're filming. How did you know that?
Because, man, I demanded to know why I was supposed to call in. I didn't know, I didn't want to walk into a trap.
No, dude, no trap. Just nice to talk to you. It's always fun when you're on the show.
And congratulations, man. Congratulations, and thank you for thinking of me, man. I was really touched.
What
a wonderful relationship we have.
Yeah, it started with you pissing on our floor, and it ends with a TV show.
We've come from that wonderful golden shower.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun, wasn't it?
I guess. I mean, really, to be honest, I don't know if I was even having a lot of fun those days, but.
It's interesting. Steve-O's our guest. I was just reading some of your stuff on Killer Karaoke, and that brought up a whole bunch of other information on Wikipedia. But, like, you're 5 years sober now.
That's right. 5 years, 4 months, and, 6 days.
Wow. How do you feel?
It's great, man. You know, I mean, not every day is a good day, but...
What do you mean? What do you mean not every day is a good day?
I don't know. I get trapped in my head, and I can manufacture misery pretty efficiently. but whatever, man. For the most part, life's great. Mm-hmm. I'm super stoked.
When you say that you're 5.5 years sober or whatever it is? Do you ever have in watching what happened to Cory Monteith? Did you hear about all this stuff?
Sure. Yeah, man, I didn't know the guy or anything like that, I don't really know much about what his situation was.
It was heroin, heroin and alcohol, and we were talking about it this morning, how unbelievable heroin must be for, some people to throw away some, like, really promising lives and careers.
Yeah, it must be delicious.
That's what I say.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm fortunate, man. I never even laid eyes on heroin.
Really?
It wasn't in the cards for me. It's so funny, too. I remember, I remember meeting this kid in a rehab somewhere, and we were talking about, he was saying that his drug of choice is heroin, and I was saying, I never even saw that stuff, man, and I feel so lucky because all it would have taken for me is just for one hot chick to just say, hey, you want to try this? And this kid looks at me and he says, dude, he says, all it took for me was one ugly guy.
He was weak.
One ugly dude.
That's a terrible story to tell your friends, isn't it? It was an ugly guy.
Well, yeah, it's an ugly dude. It's pretty good, man. But in any case, no disrespect to Cory Monteith. I know a lot of people are really bummed to hear that, man. And that's what happens, man. Like, people die. I've had I've had three friends, die in the last month and 1 week. It happens.
From an overdose?
Yeah, it was one heart attack, I think, and I don't know if it was a heart attack. The dude was had relapsed, and then two overdoses. Yeah.
Well, take us through the stuff with Cory Monteith. The rehab is in a world that I have experienced, thank God, by the grace of God anyway. But take us through, you get to rehab, you were there for how long, and what happens? Like, because he just got out, but what happens in the rehab process when you go through a system?
I mean, it depends, I think that the best way to describe rehab is to compare it to a gym, you know? One gym's not really better than another gym if it's more expensive or fancier. And, you know, the gym, it's really up to you.
Some people go hardcore.
The question is, what do you do at the gym? You know, do you go there? Are you picking up the weights? Are you doing the work? Are you getting in shape? You can't really blame the gym or the rehab for not being sober or fit. And from what little I know about the Cory Monteith guy, it sounds like he, jumped in for a little spin dry kind of deal. You know, like he went last April, and I don't know how long he went, but I know in my case, when I went to treatment, I stayed in treatment for a full 6 months. And then upon leaving treatment, I moved straight into a sober living house, and I stayed in that, in a halfway house until I had 2 full years of sobriety. And what that meant for me was, peeing into a plastic cup at random twice every week, up by 9 a.m. with my bed made, scrub the toilet, the whole deal, home by curfew. It was pretty gnarly, and that's what I needed. I was confined to institutions for 2 years, and that was voluntary too. You know, I didn't have any judge saying that I had to be there. I just I knew, how serious my situation was, and I don't even know how I was that willing, but spending two full years in that kind of environment. You know, by the time I had those 2 years, my whole life was just different. You know.
Yeah, and you know, some that's I guess the what I'm asking is that you've gone from he still lived the life that he was living. You've changed everything other than the fact that you still run around and do the stuff that you do, but that's your job. But you changed everything. You're vegan. You've really your whole life changed after that. And when you have a problem like he had and like you had, is your suggestion or maybe your summary? Some people go in for like a quick clean me up real quick and
28 days thing.
And then
they call it a spin dry, I guess. But then again, I don't know because it's not like I'm out of the woods, you know. I mean, there's all the things that we do to maintain our sobriety, and if you're not doing those things, then odds are you're not going to stay sober, you know. And again, I don't know what his situation was, but it's a precarious deal. Like I said, people die all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Ever since I got sober, I've been, super serious about it, and I've been fortunate to stay active in all these things that we do. That could very easily change. You know, there's nothing special about me that says I'm going to stay sober.
It takes work.
Well, I think even just listening to you, the special part, and there is, to be able to change that kind of stuff. But, you don't have this opinion that you're above it, or you're never going to relapse, or you're
not
just
at all, man. Yeah. You can't. You can't at all.
Mm-hmm. Is it hard today still sometimes? I mean, are there situations you can't put yourself in? Because I think when it comes to the Cory Monteith thing, he went back and hung out with his old friends, and there's pictures of him the day before everybody was drinking and having a great time, and he obviously had some pretty intense personal struggles and stuff. But not putting yourself in that situation, is that part of it for you as well?
It's really just a question of asking yourself, do I have a legitimate reason to be in this situation? You know, if I'm going to be in a situation where people are drinking or whatever, I just need to ask myself, what's my purpose being there? Do I have a legitimate reason? And, in my case, I travel around doing comedy shows all over the place, and people are drinking everywhere. I absolutely have a reason to be there, and so I don't know. I mean, it sounds like It sounds like maybe like living vicariously or whatever, just partying, getting loaded. You know, that's not a good deal. But for the most part, I steer clear. You know, I don't put myself in situations like that, really.
Yeah. Well, and that's, you know, that's the tipping point for a lot of people, too, right, is they get out of doing all that stuff and then they get back into it because they think, well, you know, I'm not going to drink, but I can still hang out with those people that do that stuff.
Yeah. I mean, I guess some people can, and I don't really. I mean, I remember when we were filming Jackass 3D, I had sort of a little bit of time on the pity pot because, you know, we would finish up a day of filming and, you know, the whole cast and crew would go straight to the bar. You know, they might, like, go back to the room and, like, you know, take a dump or something, but it was like, you know, it was like whatever, you know, and straight to the bar. And I would go back to my hotel room and I would just be kind of sitting there knowing that everybody was in the bar, and I would be feeling like sad, like I was, you know, really missing out on the camaraderie of getting together and in the bar after a day's work, and all of that sort of, you know, sadness and self-pity would last about 30 seconds before I realized, you know, if I go to that bar and pick up a drink, there is no day of work for me to have any camaraderie after, you know, like, and that's just the reality. So I'm, you know, went through that whole, you know, filming that movie. And when we make those movies, you know, like it's always like 6 months, you know, and I never through all the filming, through all the promotion, I never once, you know, sat down at a bar to watch everybody drink. It just, I didn't have a reason to do it, you know.
What do you fill your life with after that stuff, though? Like, you know, I guess, you know.
For me, most recently, surfing, man. You know, like, I dove into surfing in the biggest way, man, and I love it, dude. It's like one-stop shopping for me, man. Like, I've been surfing for, a little over a year and a half.
Are you good?
I'm not great. Considering I've only been surfing for a year and a half, I'd say that I'm really good. I dove in pretty hardcore, you know. Like in my year and a half, I've surfed in Hawaii, Costa Rica, Canada, Nicaragua.
Where do you surf in Canada?
I went to Tofino.
Oh, in BC. Oh, yeah.
And I said, so awesome. I just went on my own. I was like, I looked it up online, like, because I really like Canada, and you know, in a sort of, you know, gloom and doom, you know, economic collapse, apocalyptic scenario, I think Canada's the place to be. And I'm fortunate to have a Canadian passport because my mom was born in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my dad was born in America, and I was born in England. So I have all three passports. And, you know, I was just checking out. I was like, man, you know, if it all hits the fan, I want to go to Canada, but can I surf there? And I just went on this crazy mission to Tofino in January and surfed for 4 days in sub-zero weather, you know, thinking that if I could have a good time there.
You went in January?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have summer.
I know, but my philosophy was like, if I can have a good time there during the coldest month of the year, then I can totally have a great time there all year round. And I went there just kind of scattered out, you know, because I do picture myself winding up in Canada. I love Canada.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I went there and I had a good time. And I kind of also thought, like, dude, what am I thinking, you know? I'm not going to live in Tofino.
You can drive the whale watching boat.
Yeah, or you can maybe just surf right into the hippies that live there, too, and the hipsters.
Right. But it was cool, though, man. I had a great time. And I you know, I got some photos surfing in this, you know, just wild scene.
Let me ask you something. So and I didn't know this, but in 2000, and you coming back to Canada, but you in Calgary in 2011, you got arrested when you came back to Canada.
Right.
How awesome was that?
It was just hilarious, man, because, I was there and you know, everywhere I go on my comedy tour, I'm always doing press. Like, there I was in Calgary on the morning news and, they asked me on the news, live TV, they said, have you ever been to Calgary before? And I said, oh, yeah, I was here in 2003. We did a big show on New Year's, but we kind of beat this guy up, and we ran away from cops. You know, I fled from the show itself, running from cops because we kind of beat this guy up.
Is that a true story? And, you outran the police?
I think that it wasn't as much of a question of outrunning the police because we sort of began running before they got there. I'm not saying I'm that fast of a runner.
It was just good planning.
I got a slight head start, you know, and I remember doing my show there. It was, a huge crowd, at least 1,500 people. It was a sold out show. And right in the middle of my show, which at the time consisted of, a lot of, just masochistic sort of self-destruction and drinking and drugging. And in the middle of my show, some guy, sort of came on stage with his team. He just plain sucker punched me. He just walked up and just sucker punched me. Not that it took much to sucker punch me. He could have been standing in front of me. I probably wouldn't have seen him. But, And right at the point when this guy punched me, we had a little sort of posse, that just kind of all ran in and tackled the guy, and they're all beating him up, just like egregiously beating this guy up, particularly Preston Lacey, who is like grating the guy's forehead off with a microphone. everyone's just punching him and beating this guy up, and the thing was that at the point right when they got him, I'm on the microphone on the PA saying, beat that guy up, like send him to the hospital or whatever, sort of egging them on to really beat this guy up.
Yeah.
And security guards came in and they had they basically had the guy by the arms and legs and went to carry him, sort of remove him from the building, and they're carrying him by, and as they carry him by, just for good measure, I rear back and kick the guy like as hard as I can in his stomach. It was like,
he didn't have enough getting gangland beat like that. You thought, what the hell? Let's boot him one more time.
Pretty much. I had come into Calgary and every other, many other trips to Canada, for that matter, without incident, I'd come through customs. But there was just something, I don't think terribly coincidental about me, sort of confessing to this crime and running from cops, and talking about it on the news. And then, a few days later, there I am, and I leave the, I go to customs on the way out. I show my passport, and the guy says, hey, just go into this room. I'm thinking, I had no idea. I was like, okay. I go and sit in this waiting room, and sure enough, these cops come in, and I say, what's this? They say, you have an outstanding warrant. We're taking you into custody. It's so funny to call it an outstanding warrant.
Outstanding? There's nothing outstanding about it.
Right. It makes it really sound like pretty cool. Outstanding.
You have this. Too bad it wasn't called a totally sweet warrant.
Right. And, it wasn't mediocre at all. It was outstanding.
Nothing mediocre. But.
Were they at least Mounties, like in their full Mountie outfits?
It was airport police. And they took me off to a local. It's right. I did. I had that warrant. That warrant had been outstanding since 2003. And, I got it taken care of, man. I guess I'd chalk that up to the amends process. That was something that needed to be taken care of. And I think at the time for me, it was it was really kind of a beneficial thing. I spent, 14 odd hours at the local police station there, just kind of in a holding cell. And that sucked, but,
you know, at the time, I think it was pretty helpful for me because in my little holding cell there, like, you know, what I saw, you know, like through the bars was just this procession, you know, person after person. Every person that came into that jail that day while I was in there was just cross-eyed wasted, covered in blood, this and that, you know, it was just like, wow, you know, and I think that, that at the time it was a really sort of helpful thing for me to sit there and see, like, really, like, what's at stake there, you know, and if I wasn't, you know, if I was drifting away from you know, my sort of, I guess, you know, activities in the sober community, that was a really good sort of, you know, a re-energizer for me to be psyched about doing all my work, you know.
Good for you, dude.
That was how I looked at it anyway.
Yeah, no, and it's all one of those things too, right? You know, it's kind of lingering. It got taken care of, so you know, it's good to clear all that stuff up.
Taken care of, you know. Plus, it was you know, I mean, I'm still an attention whore at heart, man. You know, and you know, I don't think that I've ever, and this goes on to this day. I think I can confidently say that I have never been arrested for something that I really felt super bad about. I mean, I guess beating that guy up and kicking him, you know, whatever, you know.
It's a bit of a rush, though, eh?
I guess I sort of felt bad about beating, but he punched you first.
Yeah, he started it.
He punched me first. I remember, too, like I was sitting in that cell for like I said, 14-odd hours that day, and they put me in front of, like, a video judge. Remember the cop coming to my cell? He says, "Hey, you know, you started out as the victim in this case, you know, but by the time it was done, you know, you know, here you are, you know." And I mean, I suppose that is a violent crime, you know. I mean, and I think it's my only violent crime. I've never been a terribly violent dude. I certainly, I'm not a fighter, and. In that case, you know, the guy was restrained, you know, like, yeah. I am the biggest coward. When it comes to stuff like that.
It's called, I think that's called British karate, dude, is when you kick a guy that's being restrained by several other people.
Yeah, it's outstanding.
Right, British karate. Yeah. That's good, and I really like that.
You know,
for the most part, like, and I wouldn't even necessarily say I feel terribly bad about this one, you know? I mean, I've had a colorful arrest record. I got international drug smuggling in Sweden, and in Louisiana I got arrested for felony obscenity, for stapling my scrotum to my leg. You know, like, there's been, like, some pretty, there was peeing on potato chips in Philadelphia. it's just been, like, really funny arrests. Like, kind of
whose potato chips did you urinate on, Steve-O?
It was at Lollapalooza, and I was headlining the second stage of the Lollapalooza tour, and, you know, after each show, I would, I don't know. I would start selling signed DVDs and stuff. I had, like, a line of people, you know, waiting to get, like, a DVD signed or something. And I didn't care to leave everybody waiting. You see, you know what kind of guy I was. I wanted to sort of man my post. I wanted to do my thing, stick with the fans. And so I pulled out my wiener and peed on some potato chips right, you know, in front of, like, the whole line. And I'm proud of that to this day.
Yeah, should be.
For the most part, I'm pretty much proud of everything I've been arrested for, you know. Like,
yeah.
I would maybe do things a little differently today. But yeah, and all of my colorful arrests, they all brought media attention that I was very, very happy with.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's cool, man. I mean, like, haven't been sober for a few years. When I got arrested in Calgary that last time, I think that was a good little thing. You know, it made me seem a little edgy and gnarly.
Yeah, that's you. Hey, dude, we really appreciate your time. Thank you very much for helping us out this morning.
You know, like I said when I got on, man, like,
just glad to hear that that you guys have this project going. I mean, I really hope it gets picked up, man. And you know, I just appreciate you guys so much, man. I love that we have this relationship, and I love that you guys spotted me. So
come up and see us again.
Yeah, no problem, brother. Hey, me too. I do appreciate you, love you, and I'm proud of you, and good work. And I hope to see you soon, man.
Yeah, man. I'm sure that I will be there before long, and I have no doubt that I'll see you when I'm there. So thanks again, guys. You guys have a great day.
You too, brother. Take care.
All right, man. Bye bye.
Bye bye. Yeah, see, there's no one better.
No,
there is no one better.
I like he collects his arrests like playing cards.
Yeah,
though,
he thinks it's awesome.
There's the pissing in the chips one.
Yeah, whipped out my wiener. And no one says wiener like Steve-O.
No,
nobody.
It has more meaning.
Yeah, he's a beaut.
Bored, lonely, hard up. Use your free hand and follow the boys on Twitter.
At Dean Blundell Show.
The Dean Blundell Show. 102.1.
The Edge.
Joining us in studio, the biggest human being who's ever been in studio, wow. From the Denver Broncos, Toronto Zone, Orlando Franklin, maybe. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you guys doing?
You look so tired, man. You do. You came in, I'm like, hey, how's it going? And you're like, it's all right.
Coffee.
Well, normally I wake up around 10 o'clock, so I don't work out until 11 o'clock every day. So.
Are you going to work out today?
Oh, definitely.
What do you do? Take me through one of your workouts. You do burpees? Do you do any jumping jacks?
Oh, no, not at all. Those are college days.
You left the...
I left that behind in college.
Yeah, attaboy. Good. Yeah. So what do you do? So you get to the gym. Take me through. What do you do?
Well, I work out at St. Mike's with this guy named Matt Nicholas. He's actually... was with the Toronto Maple Leafs for a while, and he did a little stuff in the NFL for a couple of years. But I'll do my weight training with him, and then after that, I jump in my car and I shoot all the way to Markham, with Victoria Park and Denison at 848, and I do a lot of my speed training with this guy named Ian Warner. He's actually Justin and Ian Warner's father, those Canadian sprinters that were actually in the Olympics this year. So
yeah.
I grew up with those guys, so... He does a lot of training for me and does a lot of speed work with me.
Do you do the thing in the tires you see in the NFL where you jump like one foot in the tire, another foot in the tire, like that kind of stuff? Is that what you do?
Yeah, it definitely changes from day to day.
No jumping jacks, though, huh?
No, no. You crawl over the brick walls with the rope, you know?
I think that's earlier on in your life.
do you the one where you, like, is your training camp, right? Is training camp started already?
No, training for us starts on the 24th.
Are you excited? You guys loaded up this year?
Yeah, we're loaded up. Definitely not excited. Training camp ain't fun.
It isn't? Take us through a day like your first, because a lot of guys, they come, I know the NHL guys, a lot of guys, they come into shape and they come into camp and they're, you know, they've had a summer, they've had a few beers, yeah. they've enjoyed some summer cooking. They haven't done a whole lot because it's a tough job. So what happens? Like, take me through one of the worst days.
All the days are worse. All the days are bad. No day's more fun than the other. It's just all day, every day. In training camp, it's designed to like pretty much wear you out as an individual. So it's all day, every day, and they schedule your day so you pretty much just get 8 hours of sleep.
Wow.
And then you're right back at it. So whether it's you're waking up at 7 a.m. in the morning pretty much, and
yeah.
You got to check in for breakfast and be done breakfast by 7:45, and then you got meetings, and then after meetings you got to be on the field, and then after you're on the field you come back to meetings and you got to lift, and then after that you got meetings again, and then you might go on the field again for a walkthrough, and then you got meetings again. And
sounds like here.
Sounds like you really don't like meetings.
I mean, meetings and stuff were cool when I was a rookie, but, you know, it's kind of the same system. So
yeah.
I tend to be in meetings like, oh, my gosh, are we really installing this again? But
yeah.
It's football, so I definitely do love the game, but I do hate training camp.
Sorry, go ahead, Derek.
Oh, I was going to say, is your job assured, or is it just constantly competing with all these young guys coming out of college and stuff like that, or are you safe?
Yeah, you know what? Can you not ask him insightful questions? Like, because I'm afraid he's going to get mad.
Oh,
no.
No, but I mean, that's the pressure you feel in camp, right?
Yeah.
You're competing. So does that even bring it?
I know right now, I really don't feel any pressure going into this season. You know, I'm actually in a great position. We did draft a right tackle. We did draft a tackle to come in the sixth round this offseason, but he's
a big butt. He sucks, doesn't he?
No, it's not even that. It's just more of a development thing, and he's going to be a swing tackle later on, like for his career probably. So I know our offensive line is pretty much solidified. I know Clady's going to start at left tackle. I'm going to start at right tackle. It's going to be pretty interesting, though, at the right guard position because Chris Cooper, who they paid big money to about 3 years ago. He actually got hurt a lot last year, and they brought in Luis Vasquez from the San Diego Chargers. So, and they just paid Luis, I think it was $5 million a year. So it's going to be really interesting to see who beats out who at that position.
Yeah, well, and I read, too, that he was your roommate, this Vasquez guy.
Yeah, he
And he pissed you off.
Yeah, his house was not closed on, so he hit me up, asked me if he could stay with me for a couple of days, and you know, being the nice guy that I am, I told him, yeah, why not? But he shows up, and the first night we go out a little bit, and we were hanging out, and we come back, and I'm actually on this meal program, and he just comes back, and I guess he's not even thinking, but he just eats my like one of my meals for the next day, and I'm just like, bro. Like, I woke him up that morning. I'm like, listen.
Did you wake him up to ask where your food went?
Yeah, I was like, yeah, you can't be doing that because at the end of the day, now you're eating one of my meals. I'm going to end up at KFC or something like that. So you can't do that to me.
Did he say sorry at least?
Yeah, definitely. He was actually on a meal plan also, but his started like 3 days later. So he's like, I'll give you a meal back. But I was like, it really doesn't make no sense because it's not gonna help me out now. Three days later,
gone. You know what I mean? You go back in time, you can give me my meal back. Yeah. Orlando Franklin, Denver Broncos is here talking a little bit about the upcoming season. Now, I read today that there's a strict rule that no one touches Peyton Manning.
I mean,
you're not allowed to touch him. You can't shake his hand. You can't pat him on the back.
Really?
You can't hug him if he does something great. No one touches Peyton Manning. Is that true?
Nah, not at all. Peyton's actually a real down-to-earth person.
Eye contact, though?
I don't really see that.
Are you allowed to call him by his first name, or do you guys have to call him Mr. Manning?
Nah, everybody calls him Peyton, PM, P. Like,
call him P?
I mean, that's just what we call him, yeah.
How's his neck? Is he going to be able to play this year?
I mean,
he's fine now? Like new?
He's fine, given the season that he had last year, so I'm excited to see him build upon that.
Yeah, it's going to be exciting to watch you guys play. Who are some of the key signings you guys had in the offseason?
Well, we signed Luis Vasquez, so like I said, it's going to be interesting to see who's going to end up playing beside me. But Wes Welker, obviously, that was a big deal for us. You know, anytime you could go out and get a player of that caliber and bring him to your team, especially with already the receiving core that you already had, is definitely going to make us even that much more dominant. So we're excited about that, and I guess we got a couple guys on the defense, but as you guys know, I don't really pay attention to defense.
Yeah, defense doesn't win rings, man. Offense wins rings. Orlando Franklin, Denver Broncos, is here. Now, you are getting married?
Nah, I'm getting ready to get engaged here in a little bit.
What do you mean you're getting ready to get engaged? How do you get ready to get engaged?
I'm going to propose after the training camp.
Well, that's not going to be a surprise.
Well, she's in America. She's not listening to this radio show.
Oh, so you don't mind me saying that?
Yeah, it's not a big deal.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Because sometimes guys get a little upset when they do the personal. But I'm going to tell you, it's a stupid idea. it really is. It's a terrible, but yeah, and I know you to get married, but it never works out.
So are you going to freeze the ring?
I hope it does, right?
Freeze the ring in an ice cube and put it in her drink or something?
We're going to... Italy for the bye week, so we're going to be there for about 7 days, so I plan on doing it there.
Wow.
Nice.
So I hope she doesn't ever hear this. Or she probably knows it's coming.
I mean, it's probably expected.
You going to sign a prenuptial agreement?
Yeah, definitely. Well, her family... The thing about it is she grew up in football, so her dad's actually Bobby Turner. He coaches for the Washington Redskins, and her dad actually coached under Shanahan for 18 years for the Broncos, so she understands all that stuff, and she's actually all for it.
Oh, does she really?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, you can marry her then if she's okay.
Yeah,
like
she
that.
Sounds cool.
The Orlando Franklin Foundation, tell us a little bit about it before we go.
It's just pretty much a foundation for at-risk teens and helping them with the transition to adulthood and just teaming up with different people in the community and trying to strengthen different community ties to help out the kids these days.
But this is something cool though, because you grew up in community housing, you were saying.
Yeah, I grew up in Toronto community housing.
And this you spent, and it was an interesting conversation we had before we went on the air. You spent the day yesterday with Chief Blair and
Eugene. He's actually the CEO of
community housing. So you spent the day in Danzig yesterday. Is that correct?
We were in Danzig and Galloway yesterday.
And what was that like? What's the community like? I mean, it's a terrible situation last year that happened at the barbecue. And are things starting to come around?
I mean, yeah, it's definitely a terrible situation. But at the same time, yesterday I seen a lot of people celebrating life. So it was actually a great experience for me going into Danzig and seeing those guys and seeing how how they responded to Chief Blair coming in and Eugene coming in, because those guys are doing great things for the community, and the community definitely loves them.
It's nice that you come back, and it's nice that you give back, and it's always great having you here. You're just and just so you know, folks, you I read this morning you wanted to get down to 315 pounds. Is that correct?
Yeah, right now I'm about 322 right now.
I'm heavier
right now. So. Yeah, but
you're looking a little portly. Saying,
but it's good. Like I've never heard someone say I want to get from 322 to 315.
Yeah, definitely. I think it definitely improved my game just a little bit more. So I'm excited about this whole weight loss thing.
Good for you, dude. Well, listen, it's great to see you. You're a great guy. And are you on Twitter? Can people get you on Twitter?
Yeah, I definitely saw your Twitter handling on my way over here, and you got entirely too many Twitter followers. So I was just like to tell everybody to go ahead and follow me at OFranklin74. Once again, that's OFranklin74.
You know, I'll tweet it for you so you can get some more.
I mean, hopefully I get some followers. Hopefully, just keep retweeting it, right?
Okay, great to see you, brother. Thanks so much for your time.
Hey, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
Anytime. Go Broncos. It's funny because when you meet him, you he's such an easygoing guy. And then you go watch video. You'd never guess that he could tear someone's arm out of its socket and beat him with the wet
part. It on the field.
Then. Yeah, exactly. Thanks for your time, brother.
Good to see you.
Sir, thank you. Thank you.
Okay, here you go. The Dean Blundell Show, 102.101.
Yes. Me, your life is full of sorrow. Y'all listen up, this chick sees tomorrow.
Oh! Get mad, it's like that. Get mad.
It's Psychic Nikki on the Dean Blundell Show.
Come on.
It's Psychic Nikki on the Dean Blundell Show.
It's the queen, y'all.
It's Psychic Nikki doing my thing.
Yeah, your thing still is tone deaf.
I just did my thing, Dean.
Well, that's gross.
Yeah, poor thing.
It was gross. I kind of like my singing. I don't know.
No, it's not bad. How are you?
I'm good.
Yeah?
It's great to be back.
Nice to see you.
It is.
Yeah. Great to see you.
Missed you guys.
Okay.
Yeah.
So a couple of things that I want to get to. One of course, the flood.
Yes. That was a big prediction.
Yeah.
Yeah. And remember I predicted it. I said it would be like Hurricane Hazel 1954.
Way more rain.
Yeah.
We had way more rain. So actually you weren't accurate.
Well, similar to the Hazel.
Similar to the Hazel?
Similar to Hazel.
Yeah.
Okay. But they compared it to Hazel.
They did compare it to Hazel. Did. Hey, now, for those of you who don't know what that means, what year was that? 1962?
No, it's like 54 or 55.
54 or 55?
Yeah. 1954.
Hurricane Hazel washed out some stuff here and dumped a lot of rain. Now, you said more stuff's going to happen too, right?
Yeah, and I said that cars would be underwater, Union Station would be flooded, remember?
Yeah.
Yeah, all of that stuff.
Yeah.
All that stuff. Water going all over the city, it would be a horrible flood.
Mm-hmm.
And you said, how could that be?
No, I didn't say that.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't.
You didn't?
No, I never said that.
Oh,
I said
goodness,
I was. I said
I probably.
Yeah.
Derek did.
Well, because
Derek treated you poorly for years.
If I may,
yes.
She said it would be as a result of a giant tsunami.
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
You attached it. No, hang on. You attached it to a tsunami, but I know you didn't say it would be. You said it would be a flood, but you still say there's going to be a tsunami here.
Yes, it's going to be another storm, a really bad storm again.
What else did you predict?
And I predicted a cow falling out of the sky, killing somebody.
Yeah, you did.
That is true.
And the cow fell through a roof and killed a man. I mean, that's a weird prediction.
Man.
What do you think?
He makes it over the moon.
Huh?
Yeah.
The cow on the moon?
No. It happened in Brazil.
Right.
And this was a neat story. A guy died when a cow fell through the roof of his house and landed on the bed where he and his wife were sleeping.
I hope they weren't having sex. No.
The man, identified as Joe Maria de Souza, was asleep when his wife Lenny at home. His wife's name was Lenny. That's hilarious. Hey, Lenny. In Brazil, when the 1.5-ton animal fell 8 feet from their roof right onto them when they were in bed.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, listen, I feel sorry for them anyway.
I don't.
It's a cow. What?
No, it's too funny. This one's too funny to feel sorry for anybody. The 45-year-old was rushed to the hospital after suffering a fractured left leg. At that time, no other obvious injuries. He was conscious and taken in normally. However, hours later, the man was pronounced dead due to internal bleeding, according to his family.
Well, you know what, Dean?
Wow.
It's the most weirdest prediction I've ever heard. Story.
If you get crushed by a cow in your sleep, I don't know how it ended up on the roof, but it did. If you get crushed by a cow in your sleep, the cow believed to have escaped by a nearby farm, climbed onto the roof of the home, which backs onto a steep hill. If that happens to you, your number is up, and it was supposed to happen. It was predestined. That guy was supposed to die when a cow fell on his bed.
Definitely fate.
Poorly constructed house, though.
Yeah, it really is.
Because I think you can support a cow on any given roof.
Wild prediction, Dean. What do you think?
Yeah, it's a crazy prediction.
Isn't that crazy?
It's nuts.
It's one of the craziest ones I've ever predicted, next to the beaver eating the man.
Usually it's the other way around.
Belarus. Oh, yeah, you're right. Right. Beaver eating the man.
Yes.
Yeah, man eating. Oh, yeah, man eating beaver? No,
yeah.
I know.
Yeah, yeah. What else?
Anyway, and I also said somebody would get killed by a cell phone, and a lady got killed by her cell phone.
Yeah, her iPhone. Did you hear that story? So she got
in China.
Her car. Yeah, it was in China. Her phone was charging, so she goes and she picks it up, puts it to her face, and boom, it electrocuted her, killed her.
But that's so sad.
That's a neat app.
It's
you got to be careful what you ask Siri to do.
Yeah, Siri, kill me.
And you got to
shock me today.
You got to be careful of your phone. Mine heated up the other day.
Oh, that's
mine. Heating up like hot.
Wow.
Yeah, I don't know why. Maybe it's my body heat.
I doubt that.
Really?
Yeah.
Why is it?
Where was it? Where did you keep it?
It was in the palm of my hand.
Yeah. Well, you probably just were holding on to it for too long.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
You mean they're supposed to heat up like that?
Yeah, they heat up. They get hot. Yeah.
Especially if you use the vibrating thing too much.
Oh, guaranteed she was using the vibrating thing too much.
That's what I figured.
Vibrating? Yeah. Oh, I have one of those.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Okay, anyway.
Oh,
good. Anyway, I see a causeway in Florida collapsing.
Mm-hmm.
Like a whole roadway near the Florida Keys.
I get it. I know what it is. Keep going. Keep her going.
Oh, okay. And I see melting glaciers flooding Alaska. Mm-hmm. I see a disease around bears around the world. Wildcats will terrorize towns in Arizona. Wildcats. Isn't that scary?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I see actually an electric car exploding.
Mm-hmm.
I see a politician being killed by a pizza. Well, what I mean by
You know who it is.
Yeah.
Huh? Oh, my God. It's Fudgy. He's dead.
Because there's a bomb in the pizza.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
It's a twist, isn't it? I didn't see that one coming.
Yeah. And then I see an explosion in a tunnel in New York, which is not good.
Okay.
I see a race car at a race flipping 360 degrees, flipping around and killing the sportscasters.
All the guys that are actually commenting?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Because
you see it at baseball games, right? You see them catching fly balls and stuff or foul balls. But you never see anything happen with broadcasters in football or NASCAR.
Exactly.
So you're saying someone's going to be trackside, the car's going to flip and kill the guys that are commenting on it?
But that's so sad.
Well, it hasn't happened yet, so it's not that sad. And it's a little far-fetched, so who knows?
I had a dream about it.
Oh, that's...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was trying to see what news... It was, like, whether it was ABC, NBC, MSNBC, or whatever.
All right.
Anyway, I see a movie star enlisting in the Army. I see a transport driver. Now, this is scary.
Yeah.
Okay? In Florida, along the highway, and I'm telling you, this is so scary. It scared me in my dream.
Why don't you tell us what it is?
Well, alligators get into his cab of his truck and start eating him.
It's like Alligator-nado.
Yeah, right.
Like you have that movie Sharknado out where the sharks get picked up by the tornado.
Exactly.
And they get thrown at people and then they eat people and they cause all kinds of problems, all kinds of mayhem. Now you're saying there's going to be one about alligators.
Alligators.
But for real.
For real. Like eating this poor guy.
Like hiding in the cab while he's driving?
Yeah, like he's eating a Snickers bar or something. You know, he's having a coffee. And then all of a sudden these alligators are eating.
That's impossible. That would be very funny.
Well,
I would like that. I would like to hear that that happened and then figure out how it happened.
Well, I hope he doesn't get killed by an alligator.
Like, how did they get into the cab of the
yeah.
car?
Something
to do with a wheel. Like, he stops on the highway to check a wheel.
Yeah.
And then the alligators come from
sneak
off,
in. Sneak because in. Because now's their chance.
And they wrap themselves around the truck.
Yes.
The wheel and sneak right through. And he even has one down there.
It's oh, horrible. He one bites his genitals?
Yeah, it's horrible.
This is your prediction?
This
your
is prediction,
prediction is that a guy is going to get carjacked by alligators.
Right. Exactly. Now.
Are you serious?
I'm serious, Dean. I'm telling you. The weirdest predictions happen on the show.
Yeah.
I'm telling you.
That one will never happen. That will never happen.
I'd be very surprised.
You will never have a group of bandit alligators.
Come on, you guys.
Carjack some guy.
The coast is clear.
Sneaky. And then go into the truck and kill the guy and eat him. And specifically, you said eat his genitals? Is that what you're saying?
Genitals, everything. Wow. Arms, legs, whatever. And he's trying to, you know, get on the, what is that thing they call? The two-way radio or four-way radio?
Yeah,
he's trying. Whatever it is,
the
right?
CB.
CB. And he's trying to warn other drivers and tell them what's happening.
About the alligators.
About the alligators. in the meantime, cab. One goes crunch. Bit off a nose.
That is
bit
ridiculous.
Off a nose. It's so scary.
It's ridiculous. It's not even scary.
It isn't?
No.
And if any horror movie producers listening,
what?
Don't steal my
what
idea.
Kind?
No, honestly,
horror movie producers.
102.1 The Edge. Time for a couple phone calls for Psychic Nikki. 416-870-EDGE, 870-3343. Joanne.
Good morning.
Morning.
I've been waiting a long time. Anyways, I wanted to ask her. I had spoken to her in 2005. I was single back then. And she had told me about these two men, how one of them was absolutely gorgeous but totally poisoned to me. And then there was another, which I ended up with for 5 years. Of course, he met his first love again on Facebook and left me.
What?
This is not good.
Facebook.
You know,
hold it. Don't swear, by the way. I'm going to tell you something, though. He wants you back, the Facebook guy?
No, he wants me back.
No, because he's on Facebook, not because he cheated on you.
No, but let's see what
Facebook's
she says.
For losers. No.
I can't talk too much because I'm at work.
Oh, so am I. anyway, like what is your sign astrologically?
Tards.
What is maybe, your sign?
Maybe it's okay.
Virgo.
Oh, you're a Virgo.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm sorry to tell you this, but there's somebody else besides a guy on Facebook, too.
Oh.
You're going to have two again.
Okay.
At the same time?
Ooh.
It could be. No, 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 Dean. No, not like
better
that.
Better start practicing your Kegels.
Right.
LinkedIn.
Right. Or send them to me. No, okay. I'm only kidding. Anyway, you're a Virgo, which is good. And next year it's very good. And this year it's even better because the Jupiter's in Cancer, the planet of luck Jupiter. Oh. Uh-huh. And that is great for the Earth signs as well. It's very favorable.
Okay.
Very favorable. Which
what's
means,
she wants to know if she's going to get back together with this loser on Facebook.
I think she'll get back with the loser, but there's also going to be...
It's not going to last long.
No, there's somebody else.
So you guys might be friends with benefits. How old are you?
Hold on one sec. 56.
Hold on one sec? Hold on one sec on the radio?
56.
You're 56.
Okay. You're going to have a receding hairline. Mm. The man
she is?
Wow.
Yeah, I should have. Sorry about
ma'am,
that.
Ma'am, you're going to go bald.
Sorry get away
in
56.
All the wrong places.
No, actually, you're going to meet another man besides the one on Facebook with a receding hairline.
And a small penis.
Okay.
And blue eyes and kind of like.
Does he have a small penis?
No.
Actually, it's about 7 inches.
Oh, seven.
And it's got gray hair around there. So I see gray
it's
hair.
It's got gray pubes?
Yeah, gray pubes. Not a very good thing. You should dye it. Anyway.
Anybody that dyes their pubes.
You can dye it with Jolene.
Who's Jolene?
Jolene is a stuff that you take it on a spatula and you dye your hair down there.
No, you don't.
Yes, you do.
That's the dumbest thing I ever heard.
I'll take you to the drugstore.
No.
You'll see it.
I'm not going to the drugstore to buy pube dye with you.
Well, there is pube dye.
No, there isn't pube dye.
Yes, there is.
No, there isn't.
I'm telling you.
No, there isn't. There's dye that you can apply to hair, but there's no specific pubic dye.
Yes, there is, Jolene.
It's okay. I'm going to look it up right
look
now.
It up.
You're gonna bang the Facebook guy and get together with someone else.
Yeah,
great
with
day.
A receding hairline. Yeah.
You can't. Hang on. I'm gonna find out if you can help.
Hi, this is Psychic Nikki for pube dye.
Listen, I I've used it.
Oh, that is gross.
No, it isn't. Everybody, when
I don't want to know about
it,
your...
It goes blonde.
Jolene? Like you... Jolene? Dye?
Yes.
Hang on.
J-O-L-E-N.
Jolene Dye. There's a person named Jolene Dye.
No, I don't mean a person.
Isn't she on next?
I mean, like, dye for down your pubic hair.
Oh, my God.
I'm telling you, any woman will Twitter you. They know about it.
No, don't know. There are how many women in this room? 1, 2, 3. Hands up if you've dyed your pubes. Not one person.
Listen.
Hands up if you've even heard of this. Nicole, you're just trying to get on the radio.
No, Nicole's heard of it. They've got a website. Joel.
What's that? Hold it. Microphone guy. It's Eric. Eric? Eric, sorry. What did you say, Joe?
You can do it for your brows and your eyelashes.
Yeah, you do your eyebrow, but there's no such thing as pubic dye.
You put it down there.
You can put it anywhere you like.
It's just hair.
You can do your butt hair. You can do your arm hair. What I'm saying is
it's
they don't
made
have pubic
specifically
dye.
For your pubes.
That one in particular is for pubes, trust me.
No, it isn't.
I'm telling you.
It's not. There's no such thing. I love you to death. I think you're a wacky old broad,
okay,
but I'm going to tell you this right now.
I'm a wacky old broad.
You
I'm
are.
A wacky
you
young
are.
Broad.
You're,
like,
no,
I'm,
you're old. So,
I'm not.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not.
This is on camera, so everybody can see that you are.
Oh.
So,
thanks.
But well, not that old. You're not like, you're not, you know, 90.
No, I'm not.
But you're.
Betty White is. Yeah.
Holy smokes.
You are telling people a lie. There is no such thing as pubic dye, and if there was, no one would buy it. Because only an idiot goes into the Shoppers Drug Mart and says, excuse me, where can I find the dye for my pubic hair?
Listen, Jolene...
is an idiot, whoever that is.
No, Jolene is very...
I'm looking it up. There's Jolene hair bleach, Jolene bleach instructions, Jolene hair removal. That's it. That's all there is.
All right. I'm telling you, it dyes your pubes.
I know. No, it doesn't.
Christmas is coming. Try red and green.
Friends use it.
Yeah, your friend. Which ones? Give us their names. Why don't you tell us right now on the radio?
My husband used it because he was embarrassed because it was going.
Well, why did. No. Because if you get gray pubes, you shave them.
Right. But some people dye them too.
No one dyes their
pubes. Some people like hair down there.
Has it? No one does.
Yeah. No, Dean. Dean, I'm telling you,
hands up if anybody, men or women, you like hair down there? Anybody? Lots of. No, no one does.
No, not.
Oh, you. Yeah, but you're a freak.
Right.
I have it.
But
I just don't like it.
Not everybody has the same taste, Dean. Some people prefer hair and some people prefer shaved, right?
Here. Hang on. Here. Someone sent this to me.
Okay.
It's not called Jolene. There is hair. There is pube dye.
See?
It's called Betty.
Betty?
Yeah. But it.
They must have changed the
she
name.
She does a great job.
But it's for losers. Yeah. There you can do red, green, orange, black, or turquoise.
Well, that would be good for Halloween. Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Turquoise if you're a San Jose Sharks fan.
Right.
I love the team so much I've dyed my pubes.
There's nothing wrong with dyeing your pubes.
Yes, there's lots wrong with dyeing your pubes.
Of the future, because
no,
shaving down
the
there
future.
Can give you rashes.
No.
It can. Honestly, Dean.
I know that it can.
Yeah.
That's not the point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's going to be something really bad happening in the world.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Really? Anyway.
All right, I love you to death.
Oh,
but
thank
you're, you. You're weird. And no one dyes their pubes, and if they do, they're losers.
All right.
Right? Would you say that?
I would not say that.
Yes, I would. Yes,
absolutely
you would.
Absolutely not.
If you say it with me, if you dye your pubes, you're a loser.
If you dye your poops.
If you dye your poop.
Here we go.
If you dye your...
pubes.
Pubes. Not ice cubes, pubes. You are not a loser.
You're a
winner.
You're a massive dork.
You're a massive winner.
You're a huge
you're
waste
a huge
of time.
Winner.
No. You are bored if you dye your pubes.
No, you're not
yes,
bored.
Yes, you are. And it's dumb.
You're just doing something scientific.
No. Growing mold in a petri dish is scientific.
Saving people.
Science.
Oh, all right.
Dyeing your pubes is nothing related to science.
All right. Well.
It's related to being an idiot.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is.
Oh, my gosh.
I still love you.
Thank you, Dean. Thanks, dear.
You know why she's defending it?
Because
you'll never guess who dyed their pubes last night.
Not
in a
me.
Bathroom.
Not
little
me.
Comb. Those rubber gloves.
Not me. Not me. I don't do that. I shave. I don't do that.
Okay. 416-961-7976. Get a reading. She is very good. She did predict the cow falling on the Bolivian
and
day.
Yeah, give her that.
And the flood. She predicted the flood.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, you're good.
Yeah, thank you.
She does parties. She'll come to your house, do some stuff, dye your pubes for you.
No, I will not dye your pubes.
You'll pretty much do anything for $300.
No, I won't.
Okay, $250. I'm joking.
Okay.
But anyway, give her a call. She's terrific. Psychic Nikki on Twitter, at Psychic Nikki and PsychicNikki.com.
Yeah, follow me on Twitter. That's great because I've got nearly 13,000 followers right now. Thank you, followers.
My word.
Yeah, trying for 15. And it's 416-961-7976.
Literally just said everything you said again.
Sorry, Dean.
No, you're not.
It's
it on
just the heat.
I know.
The Dean Blundell Show, 102.1 The Edge.